We can't give God anything else. Matter of fact, it's funny. Some people get mad, say they want to come to church because they don't want the pastor to have a nice car or a nice house and he living good, so I ain't going to give him no money. When you give the church money, that's not for me. That's for you. See, a lot of times people, they call me up. Matter of fact, I got a couple calls last week. Oh, man, my lights getting cut off. Oh, man, this is happening. And these are people who don't pay their tithes. When you pay your tithes, you're not doing it for me. You're doing it for you. But that covers your money. Amen. All right, tonight we're going to talk about all roads leads to truth. Bishop, get a Bible. All roads leads to truth. Open your Bible to the book of John. Grandbaby, y'all got to be quiet back there. Open your Bible to the book of John. And we're going to go to the book of John, chapter 4, verse 23. And we're going to read verses 23 through 24. The book of John. That's in the New Testament. For those of you who don't know your Bible that well, it's all right. You'll get better. The book of John, chapter 4. We're going to read verses 23 through 24. When you guys say amen.
Amen.
All right, then Reverend Ryder, go ahead and read it for me.
But the hour comes, and now is, and when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeks such to worship him. Verse 24. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
Amen. And it says, I will read it again. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. Here's the kicker. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. God is a spirit, and those of us that worship him have to worship him in spirit and in truth. Your mind can be grabbed by situations, or your mind can be stimulated by something called a revelation. Now, some of y'all young, it don't mean nothing to you. Your mind can be grabbed by a situation, or your mind can be stimulated by a revelation. A lot of you have cell phones in your pocket. What you might not know is that cell phone was a revelation. Whenever you create something new, that's a revelation. Whenever you get an idea or some kind of something to do with improving things around you, that's called a revelation. And those revelations come only from one source. They come from God. However, when we live by our senses, our five senses, anybody know the five senses that we all have? Go ahead, what are they?
Sight.
Sight.
Hearing.
Hearing.
Touch.
Touch.
Smell.
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 And the voice.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, speech. So, we live, go ahead, bitch, you going to add something to
that? Taste.
Taste, thank you, son. Taste. So, when we live by the senses, we live by sight, smell, speech, taste, and feel. When we live by the senses, we're living by those five senses. Guess what? God cannot talk to you through your senses. He cannot talk to you through touch and taste and smell and feel. He can't talk to you through your senses. God only talks to you through your spirit. He only communicates to you through your spirit. Now, what is funny is Satan talks to you through your senses. Satan talks to you through your senses. Satan will talk to you through your eyes. Pornography, biggest addiction. He will talk to you through your taste. He will talk to you through smells. He will talk to you through feels. Satan will talk to you through all these different senses. Your senses connect you to the world. Satan is the god of this world. So he will communicate to you through your senses. God will not talk to you through your senses. He will talk to you through revelation, which is the spirit. When God talks to you, he's going to talk through your spirit. Satan is going to talk to you through your senses. What you see, how you feel, what you taste, what you hear, what? She said that, let's get it, you know, and you know, all those different things. So we have to understand the way that God communicates with us. Satan's job is to try to sway you from your purpose through your senses. I won't say no name, but there was some young people, hey sister, there was some young people who went into a Target store recently, and they saw some things that they wanted. See, Satan will tempt you through your eyesight. He will tempt you through what you see. Or, you know, for example, we've been watching the TV lately, and all you see on the news is, what is it, the place? Virginia.
Charlottesville.
You see that? He will tempt you through what you see. That's how he communicates with us. He communicates with us through how we see. However, God only talks to us through our spirit man. And that spirit man is the deep inner being that speaks to your core. And it often tells you the right thing to do. Here's what's funny. Right before you get ready to do something wrong, guess what? Something probably talks to you that, don't do this. And so the thing is, we often ignore that voice and we do whatever we want to do. Then we get in trouble. Then we end up in situations. Turn to the book of Romans. Romans chapter 8. So we have to look for the spirit man. The spirit man. We have to communicate with the spirit man. Romans chapter 8, go down to verse 16. We have to communicate through the spirit man. And we have to understand that Satan will communicate with us through our senses. Romans 8, go down to verse 16. Poppy, you got it? You got it, say amen. All right, Poppy, read.
The Spirit himself testifies together with our spirit that we are God's children.
Amen. The Spirit itself bears witness with one spirit that we are the children of God. In the Living Bible translation, it says, for his Holy Spirit speaks to us deep in our hearts and tells us that we are really God's children. The Holy Spirit will speak to you deep in your heart. It will communicate with you. God talks to us through our spirit. You will never hear this.
Get out of the car.
God will never talk to you that way. If you ever hear God speak aloud, you will die. God will never speak to you aloud. He will always speak to that inner voice. It'll be a soft voice. Bishop, when should we be doing our prayer?
In the morning.
Early in the morning. Bishop, why should we do prayer early in the morning?
It's quiet.
Because it's quiet. God is not going to speak real loud. He's not going to be real loud. You got your Nicki Minaj turned up, your Corvette black blasting. He's not going to yell over all those things. He's going to speak in a soft voice on the inside. He's going to speak to your spirit. He's going to speak to your core. Amen. So when we watch the news and we see all this civil unrest and protest and all these things are telling us to fear, fear, fear. What we have to understand is we are operating in spirit. We're not operating by what we see. We're not operating by the things that you see. We're operating in spirit. People often ask me, Mike, you moved to Compton. Yes. Oh my God, you moved to Compton? Are you crazy? And I'm like, no. Oh my God, you scared? No, because I moved to Compton in spirit. The spirit spoke to me and said, move to Compton. The spirit spoke to me and said, do these things. If the spirit leads you, then you go forth in confidence. You don't go forth by what you hear. How about what you see? And many of us do that. We lead our lives based on what we hear and see. Yes, baby.
How do you know when it's the spirit talking to you
and
not something else?
Amen. That's good. How do you know when it's the spirit talking to you and not something else? Anybody got one answer?
Try the spirit by the spirit.
Let's turn to Mark 13. That's good. That's a good question. Let's see if we got the answer. Turn to Mark 13. Mark is the New Testament, Mark 13. Hold on, it's going to get good real fast. Mark 13, and we're going to go down to verses 6 through 9. Mark 13, verses 6 through 9. The question was, how do we know when God is speaking to us and it ain't Satan that's tricking us? Amen. Let's read Mark 13, verses 6 through 9. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And when ye shall hear of wars, rumor of wars, be not troubled, for such are the things that need be, but the end it shall not be yet. Verse 8, for the nation shall rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be earthquakes in divers places, and there shall be famines and troubles. These are the beginnings of sorrows. Verse 9, but take heed to yourself, for they shall deliver you up to councils and synagogues, and shall be beaten, etc., etc., etc. All right, the question was, how do you know when God's speaking to you? Here's how you know when God's speaking to you. When God's speaking to you, it will be something that's going to benefit you, and it won't go against anything that's going to get you into trouble. For example, God wrote his laws on our heart. So when God speaks to you, it won't be anything that's going to be controversial to what you're supposed to be doing. See, if God said, if you hear this, go exercise. That's probably God speaking to you. You know, it's time to get in shape. Or if you hear something positive, something beneficial, it's time to study. Or it's time to do some work. Or, you know, that's good. But if you hear something, hey, go get that bottle yet. Okay, or go call, slide into DM. Or you know, then you know that's not coming from God. Generally, when God speaks, it's going to be something that's going to benefit you. Psalm 37:23 says, the steps of a good man are ordered. God is going to tell you to do things that's going to make do good for you. It's going to build you up. It's not going to tear you down. It's not going to tear you down. Yes, sir.
What if it's like, what if it's not like being beneficial or like bad?
What if well, it's not like, beneficial
what
or bad?
What if it's like something like in a situation?
Situation.
Yeah, like situation.
So you hear a voice in a situation.
Yeah.
Okay. So it depends on what situation. If it's a situation where somebody about to get you, you know, run or fight. If it's a situation where you got cheating on your girlfriend, lie, run. I don't know. It's situations are situations. Go ahead, why?
I believe when God speaks to you, it's going to be like you said earlier, it's going to be a confidence. You'll feel motivated, and you will know it's not something that you want to go back and forth with.
Right, so yeah.
It's going to be very powerful. It's going to be like very strong information. It's going to be something that you really know. I don't know.
Right, yeah. It's going to be from the heart. Gonna be from the heart, because the truth is written on the heart. All right, turn to Luke 8:17. We're getting to the about to get good. Just hey, if you're watching by TV, hang on in there. It's gonna be worth the ride. Luke 8:17. New Testament. Luke 8:17. When you gotta say amen. Again, guys, say hold up.
Say 8:17.
Yeah, Luke 8:17. Go ahead, read it, Papa. It says, for there is no secret that shall not be made manifest, neither anything hid that shall not be made known and come abroad. Let me translate that into English. It says, this illustration illustrates the fact that someday everything in man's heart shall be brought to light and made plain to all. Made plain to all. So it says, the truth is often hidden. The truth is often hidden. The truth is often hidden. First of all, God wrote his truth on our hearts. That's the first place. Can you see the heart? No. It's inside. It's hidden. The truth is often hidden. I have a question for you today. And the question is, who are the hidden ones? Who are the hidden ones? The Bible speaks about the hidden ones. Turn to the book of Psalms. The book of Psalms 83. The Bible speaks about a group of people that are hidden, but you can see them, but they're still hidden. The book of Psalms, chapter 83, verses 2 through 3. Who are the hidden ones? It says, God will hide his truth. The truth is often hidden. Then it says the truth will come to light. God hid his truth in our hearts. So the question is, who are the hidden ones? And then I have another question. The other question is, what's the only nation of people on the planet called Earth that don't have a home? What's the only nation of people on planet Earth that don't have a home? African Americans are the only group of people on planet Earth that do not have a home. We are the only group of people on planet Earth that do not have home. What's interesting, I was watching the Charlottesville, and I heard one of the KKK people say, go back to Africa. They told one of the girls that, go back to Africa, or go back to here and there. But what's interesting about going back to Africa is, when we were in Africa, somehow we ended up here. Does anybody know how we ended up here from Africa?
They brought us here.
Okay, I like that. Anybody know how we got here? Reverend Phil, how did we get here from Africa?
And they brought us here.
They brought us here, okay. So, what, they pulled the ships up and we just got out and got on the ships and we just
came on? We just voluntarily showed up, like we're coming on a cruise or something.
So we just voluntarily?
We were infiltrated, tricked, put on a boat.
Infiltrated and tricked?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, so they went over there and did some magic and then and we just jumped on the ship. It wasn't magic. Right. Okay.
Some people were stolen, some people came to provide a better, a seemingly better life.
Oh, that's what they tell us now. The brothers didn't need no jobs in Africa, believe me.
I'm sure.
They didn't need no jobs. All right, let's read what the Bible says. Psalms 83, verses 2 through 3. Somebody read that for me.
For behold, your enemies make a tumult, and those who hate you have lifted up their heads.
All right. In the King James, it says, for lo, thine enemies make a tumult, and they that hate thee lifted up their head. And then verse 3 says, they have taken crafty counsel against thy people and consulted against thy hidden ones. Thy hidden ones. There we see it again. Hidden ones. There are a group of people on the planet that are called hidden ones. What we're seeing here is, verse 2, it says, for lo, thine enemies make a tumult. And it says in the Living Bible Translation, they're making a commotion. And what they're doing is, they're planning and plotting against the hidden ones. They are planning and plotting against the hidden ones. They are planning and plotting against the hidden ones. Now, let me ask you something. Has anybody ever heard of the Tuskegee experiment? Tuskegee experiment. Yes. Does anybody know what that was? They gave a group of black men syphilis and just watched them die over a long period of time. Was that by accident?
No.
No. That took crafty planning and organization because it went over a period of years. Over 4 years. Thank you, baby. Has anybody heard of Flint, Michigan? Water crisis. What a water crisis. It was poison and lead in the water. Does anybody know what lead does to a brain? Let me tell you some instances of what lead poisoning does. It can make you retarded. It can make you violent. It can make you lazy. You can get ADHD. If you're male, you can have low sperm count. And all these different things just from lead in the water. Was the Flint, Michigan by accident? No, this wasn't my, let's go to another. Anybody heard of Katrina? All right, Katrina. Was Katrina by accident? No, they knew about it. Anybody heard of Chirac?
Chicago?
Which is Chicago.
Yeah.
Chirac. Did you know that in Chicago, it averages throughout the week, 85 people get shot per week. On every weekend, 75 people get shot every weekend. Now, the interesting part about this is these young people are being shot with something called submarine machine guns, Glocks, none of which are made in the United States of America. AK-47s have never been made in the United States of America. They're Russian made. Are they made in other parts of the world?
China.
In China. Are Chinese made. Yet these kids are walking around with $2,000 guns. And they ain't got $2,000, believe that. So the thing is, these are not coincidences. Here's another powerful, three strikes law. Now you guys are young and y'all were all born into this. Three strikes law came out in 1991-92. And what that says was, you got three strikes and you're out. Three crimes and you're out. You do three crimes and you get 25 years in prison. Now you might not think that's a bad deal, but here's how it goes. You go into Target and you steal some gum. While stealing gum, you hit the security over the head and you run out the store. Guess what? You just got two strikes. One for stealing and one for felony assault. So your next strike could be something simple as somebody stealing a Snicker bar. There was a man who went to prison for 25 years for stealing a piece of candy. So the thing is, you can end up with these strikes easily, quite easily. One big mistake and you got two or three strikes and you're out. And because of that, what has happened in our communities? You have 2 million men in prison. 2 million men in prison. Each of those men, Dayani, represents a father. Each of those men represents a father. So you have 2 million men in prison. Let's look at another coincidence, crack cocaine. I don't know no brothers in the hood with chemistry sets. I don't know no brothers in, how can we get cocaine into the neighborhoods? Then we have all these other different things. And here's the most powerful one, and this started in 1964, welfare. 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 In 1964, 75% of black folks had a mother and a father. 75% of black people had a mother and a father in before welfare. Fast forward to 2017, it's only 30% of us that are married. Now let's read what the Bible said again, because now it's going to make sense. Go back to Psalms 83, verse 3. They have taken crafty counsel against thy people and consulted against thy hidden ones. They have said, come and let us cut them off from being a nation, that the nation of Israel will be no more in remembrance. That the nation of Israel will be no more in remembrance. What that means is you won't remember anything about yourself. You won't remember anything about yourself. We don't even know where we come from. If we went to Africa, you know, it's all right, we Africa. Okay, let's go. Where? Where are you going in Africa? You going to go to Ghana? You going to Nigeria? You going to Niger? You going to Chad? You going to South Africa? You going to Central Africa? You going to Egypt? Where are you going? We don't know anything about ourselves. Nothing. And if you ask us, I'm from Mississippi. The Mississippians be quick to tell you, you ain't from here. You don't belong here. But then if we go to Africa, they going to be like, well, you don't belong here either. Because when you go there, they're going to be looking at you some type of way. They're going to be feeling some type of way. They're going to talk to you differently. They're going to treat you differently. So we don't know anything about ourselves. This is all in the Bible. This is not by coincidence. It is not by accident. It is right there. Let's read it again. It says, they have taken crafty counsel against thy people, consulted against thy hidden ones. They have said, come and let us cut them off from being a nation, that the nation of Israel shall be no more in remembrance. They won't have any memory of who they are. We will be a lost people. 36 million lost people who have no cultural identity. We have no origin. I'm African, black power, power to the people, black lives matter. Where you from? I don't know. Where your people from? I don't know. Where your roots at? I don't know. What's your history? Black power, that's my history, Malcolm X. Nah, bro, that's 1965. Every other American that you meet can trace their roots to somewhere. Mexican Americans can trace their roots to Mexico. Italian Americans, every other American, Native Americans can trace their roots to their tribe. We have no roots. We don't know any tribe. And you can go to DNA and do some of that. They can somehow piece you together, somehow. You know, if you do that ancestry.com, but we don't know who we are. Now, here's the powerful part of this. Turn to Revelations 5 and 5. Turn to Revelations 5 and 5. The question is, why? That's the question. Why every time I turn on the TV, it's about me indirectly? It's about me. Why when I turn on the TV, somebody's chasing me down, shooting me up, killing me, protesting about me? Why is it always about me? Turn to Revelations 5 and 5. That's way Revelations is way in the back. Way in the back. Way in the back. When you guys say amen. Alright, who wanna read the book? Somebody read it. because I ain't got
it. And one of the elders said unto me, weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof.
All right, let's read it again. And one of the elders said unto me, weep not, don't cry. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. One of the problems with the King James Version of the Bible is we don't know what it means. All right. The tribe of the Lion of Judah. The Lion of Judah. And they said this tribe was going to open the seven seals. The seven seals. It says they had prevailed. Does anybody know what the word prevail means?
Overcome.
This tribe has overcome. They have survived to release the seventh seal. Does anybody know what the seven seals are? Anybody? All right. Okay. You're an Antichrist?
Yes.
Okay. Satan, all that stuff. But before any of that go down, the seven seals have to be released. The angels will come down, release the seven seals, and then Satan, that will lead to the demise, to Satan going down. So let's translate that. Here's what that means. You are the only thing that's going to bring Satan down. He will come down because of you. And because he's going to come down because of you, his job now is to do everything in his power to destroy you. Because you are the only thing that's going to cause his demise. You're the only thing that's going to lead to him being defeated by Jesus Christ. If he can destroy you, then this won't happen. That's what this whole thing is all about. It's all about you, not even her. He ain't worried about her. It says, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. The Lion. The Lion. That big, strong man. You. It's all about you. If he can stop you, then he can stop his defeat. So since that is the key to him, he's going to do everything in his power. He's going to make sure that the boys don't grow up without fathers. He's going to make sure that there's beef between the man and the woman, that the divorce rate's through the roof, that it's sad, but of the men in prison, 95% came from single-parent homes. I mean, so he's going to make sure there's drive-by, there's guns, there's always something negative. He's going to make sure that you write songs about your women and disrespect your own mothers and disrespect your own sisters. He's going to make sure that all these different things happen. Yes, sir. That's true. Okay, that's true. So I like that. That's good. So lying, girl. You ever been in a fight? You call your sister? All right. So the thing is, you need a lion to come get your back. You ain't gonna be like, Poppy, help me, help me. You be like, whoa, let's get it, bring it, homie. We gotta get some business taken care of. You need that lion, huh?
If a girl
try
to fight you,
yeah. If a girl try to fight me, well, that's modern. He didn't call girl. That's something. I'm glad he brought that up. Young people, what they do now is, if a girl wants to fight him, he'll go call his sister and come fight the girl. This is crazy.
So what you want me to do?
What I want you to do? Walk away. But just walk away. If you have time to go call your sister, that means you had time to walk away from the situation. You know, so you can walk away from that kind of situation. So the point is, young men, Dayani, I've got your name right now, I can't think of it. What's your name, man?
Tyree.
Who?
Tyree?
Joseph, Rima, Bishop, the grandbabies in the back, Jonathan, all of you men, you have a target on your back. So when you walk through this world, you have to walk through understanding that they are looking to do anything to set you up. You cannot fall for the traps. When you get pulled over by the police, yes sir, no sir. If he talks crazy to you, he rolls his eye. Yes, sir. No, sir. It's not by accident that all these young black men start getting shot up by police. It just doesn't happen. I can see if it was one or two. But when you turn on the TV, it's one every night. And then when you saw the young brother, Philando Castile, You know, and he did the right thing.
Sir, I have a weapon. It's concealed license. I'm abiding by the law, sir. Thank you. Sir, would you like to see the paper?
Bam, 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 bam! And then get away from it? Trayvon Martin? What the, Mike Brown? And we can just keep going on and on and on and on. This is not by accident. Because see, for every one of you lions, Tyreek, that goes down, guess what? Your son don't have a father. And they know that the woman is good. A mother is good. But a mother can't raise no boy like a man. She can do a good job and do training and try her best. And some sisters manage. But 95% of the prison population were raised by single parents. Because it's hard for a woman to teach you how to bark. Remember that little doggy you had the other day? I got a big dog in the backyard. And my dog, when he goes to pee, he be like a girl. Now my dog, as vicious as he is, he's a killer. We all know that. Butterfly killer. He pees like a girl. And you know why he pees like a girl? Because he was raised by a girl. And recently he just started, because we go outside, he see a couple dogs do this. And now sometimes when we go out, he lifts his leg up to pee. Because he's been realizing, I've been peeing like a girl. It takes a man to raise a man. Now, here's the powerful part. We're going to leave you with this. All you men, I need you to make a vow to live. And what that means is, you're going to make a vow to live. And that's not as easy as you think it is. Because the enemy, like we started, when we started off, we started about the flesh. Satan's going to send you big booties. He's going to send you racks on racks. He's going to send you videos. He's going to send you all kinds of stuff. He's going to send you other fine chocolate AKAs and Simon Gamma Rose. He's going to send you all kinds of things to tempt you. He's going to send you better computers or whatever it is that you into. He's going to send you all kinds of things to tempt you. And guess what? Here's what he does. When he tempts us, he leads us down a different path. That's the whole thing. God already set your life. Jonathan, God put some crumbs on the ground, and he wants you to do this for all the path. But see, Satan's going to be like, come over here, man. Got that nickel on this side. You don't need to walk down that street. And here's what happened. We walk down these paths, and bad stuff happens. And just imagine, some of y'all end up and got a record because you followed the wrong path. So we have to understand, men, I'm not talking to the sisters. I'm talking to the men. You have to make a vow to do the right thing. You got to be careful. Things are different. I remember, I'm going to shut up after this. I had a friend in college, and she would talk mess to people. See, a girl can do that. But when you talk mess, it's a whole different discussion. So one day, she was talking mess to the neighbor. Because I guess she parked the car, the neighbor didn't like it. He's like, you need to move your car. So she said, I'm going to go get my man. She went and got her man. And she was like, you hear what he talking? See how he's saying to me? You ain't going to say nothing? And the guy was like, look, man, you know, leave my woman alone. And he said, oh, man, me? You want me? He's a Latino guy. You want me? He jumped out, ran out of his house, had a butcher knife about this big, stabbed him in the stomach. The kid died there on the street. We were in college. I can't say the girl's name because she's probably watching. So I was like, what? It's a different discussion between a man and a woman in situations. You can't do what she can do. You know, when the police pull you over, tell your woman, be quiet. Because she can run her mouth, and guess who we gonna talk to? You in the passenger seat. You ain't even driving. You in the passenger seat. But you pull me over, you know, I didn't do nothing. That's stupid.
License registration.
Hey man, I'm not even driving.
License registration. Oh, you ain't got your license registration? Get out the car.
What? Man, I'm not even driving. It happens all the time. So men, you have to walk a different path. You have to understand that they are looking to get you. Satan hates you. If you can learn that while you're 15, 16, then when you're 36 and 66, your life will be better. Satan hates you. Satan wants you. He's going to do everything he can do to distract you, Tyree, get you over here. Because guess what, Tyree? You got a beautiful son and daughter. And your son's going to be smart and tall and athletic and gifted. And he's going to do some great things. But if Satan can get you caught up and going to jail and catching the case, now you guess who's going to raise your son? Who's going to raise your son? Not even the sister. Different baby daddy, mama boyfriend, mama next boyfriend, mama next boyfriend, mama next boyfriend. So many different girls get molested. Why? Because the father is not there. They have to leave these kids at somebody's house, and they leaving these kids, the kid going from house to house to house, and they going to these houses, and a whole bunch of crazy stuff is happening in these houses, all because you ain't there. So I need you men to make a vow to be there. I want you men to be there. I make you make a vow because it's that important. Our communities will change because of a man. It's going to be a man that changes our communities. Dr. King was just one man. Malcolm X was just one man. Tupac, although he died ignorantly, he was still one man. One man can make the difference. And I see so much potential in you men. And I'm gonna shut up after this. Yesterday, I posted a picture. Bishop, what did I post on Facebook?
A painting.
It was a painting by a guy named John Michel Basquiat. And this painting sold for $110 million. $110 million. John Michel Basquiat was a homeless black kid who used to rock. He had to live on the subways in New York because his parents, his father couldn't put him out of his house when he dropped out of school. He would draw on little sheets of paper. If he found a book, he'd just start drawing in the book. And he would sell the pieces of paper to people on the train so he can get a little money and get something to eat. Long story short, he ended up handing the paper to the right man. And that man saw it and said, "This is amazing art." He went from homeless on the subway to instant superstar. He dated Madonna. He dated all the superstars. This homeless black kid on the train. So here's the whole myth of the story. You guys have so much talent in you. Joseph, if you knew how talented you were, then you work three times harder. I need to work harder. I'm slacking on my pen. You are so gifted and talented. All of you men. And I did this with my son. I said, name three great African people. He said, okay, five.
Because I named three.
Okay, he named three. Couldn't get to five. And I said, name 20 great African Americans. Denzel Washington, DeMar DeRozan, Jordan, Oprah. You could just go down. You could just keep going down this. And we ain't talking about inventors. Everything in this room was created by somebody that looked like you. Who invented the cell phone? A black man, 1971, worked for Motorola. There are so many great things. It's not by accident that all these great things came out of you. You took a rhyme, a hip, hop, a hip, and turned it into a billion-dollar industry. Are you kidding me? There's so much gifts in you. And you know why they're in you, Jonathan? Because you're the hidden ones. God put his best inside of you. Satan knows that. We don't know that because we don't know who we are. We're lost. We don't remember who we are. I remember a comedian said, we built the pyramids and forgot what we needed. Yes, we did. We forgot everything. We don't know who we are. But everybody else knows who you are. And turn to Deuteronomy 28:10. I'm out. Thank you, Louis.
Turn to what?
Deuteronomy 28:10. That's the last thing. And it'll close. Amen. You are the only thing that separates Satan from destroying this world. Satan will lie to you. He will speak to your ear. He will tell you it's nothing. It's a lie. Satan is called the father of lies. Somebody got Deuteronomy 28:10.
Go ahead, read it. All people of the earth shall see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and they shall be afraid of you.
All people of the earth shall see that you are called by the name of the Lord. And my Bible says his chosen ones, his special ones, and they shall be afraid of you. All people, Tyree, know who you are. And when they see you, they are afraid of you. And the reason why they're afraid of you, not because they think you're going to beat them up. Because in their spirit, they spirit, remember, God is spirit. God, we all have a spirit. And in their spirit, they see the God power in you. So when they see you, they revere you. They go, oh my God, there's one of them. When there's a black man who went to China. When he went to China, everybody was bowing down and praising. And he didn't know anything.
Yeah, the Chinese always bow to me, but they see
him. They know who he is. We don't know who we are. And once you start reading and find out, Jonathan, you are great, man. You got some great aunt. Find out who your uncles and your cousins and go further back. You're like, wow, my family did this? Yes, there's greatness in you. There's great, especially in your line. Well, on your mama's side, you got 3 or 4 NFL players. Y'all got 2 Super Bowl rings just by her cousins in your side of the family. Hey, man, your side of the family, you got an uncle that's a millionaire that never went to college. Because you take mother and father. That's on my side. Amen.
What?
All right, everybody stand up. Well, boys take after the mother's side. He take after her father. You take after my mother's. Amen. I heard that. All right, everybody else grab, hold hands. Grandbabies over here. Y'all didn't do too bad today. Amen. That's all right. Amen. So men, handsome, intelligent, articulate, smart, gifted, amazing, strong. I need you to bow, say, God, you know what? I've been tripping. God, I want to live. I want to live. The saddest thing that I hear when a young brother tells me, man, I ain't going to live to be 21. And I've heard a few say that. But I should not get on my big tattoo. Bro, man, I ain't going to live to be 25.
Can I show you something? Please.
Yes, sir.
Mommy. I didn't think I'd pass 33.
Right.
I made it past 33. Now I'm 59 years old.
Amen.
I didn't think I'd be
3. Right. So, we need, you got to speak life. Make better decisions. All of us, everybody in the standing circle, everybody watching by TV, make better decisions. We all can do better. There's nobody in here that's doing their best. Not one person standing amongst us and said, I did my best. Nope. All of us can make better decisions. All of us can read our Bibles more. All of us can be nicer to somebody, be more kind, be more giving. That's for all of us. All of us who are students can study more, especially if you're a genius. Put that cell phone, Snapchat down, and study. Get off that skateboard and go do something positive with your life. Amen. All right, bow your heads. Thank you, dear Heavenly Father. Yes, sir.
I got what's it called?
A prayer request.
Yeah.
Okay, yes, sir.
Healthy prosperity. Because the season is starting.
All right. Amen. All right. Anybody else got a prayer? But thank you, sir.
Me?
Yeah.
So
I
financially
stop
playing.
Okay. Amen. Get that financial aid too. Amen. Sister, our spiritual sister over here. Mm-hmm. Sister Jocelyn, you are our spiritual temperate barometer. You got any prayer requests?
I'm praying for a car.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Anything, sister?
Just our community.
Our community. Amen. And we'll pray for your career. She's a real estate agent. Amen. Bless her. All right, bow your head. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We thank you for this evening. Thank you for each soul represented here, Father. We give ourselves away, Father. We give ourselves to you, Father. We ask forgiveness, Father. We ask for prosperity in our lives, in our homes, in our careers, Father. We ask all those young men and women that are going back to school, Father, cover them, help them to study, cover their finances, Father. Cover their mind, Father. Help them, Father, to see the pathway, Father. We ask you to communicate in their spirits, Father. We ask that you guide us, Father, so that Satan can't trick us with the senses and with the frailties of this world, Father. We ask you to bless each and every one of us, Father. Cover our home. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.